putting in the right leg. Goes to right leg. Try to take all the time. No one left leg. Try to move forward, don't push back here. Riya, give her support there. Otherwise she's not able to move. Once you've extended, continue with the left one time. Okay, that's it. No middle, no left leg. Pushing out. Left leg pushing out. Row one pushing out. Everyone's extended once again. I'm going to give you 8 counts just to close, just for a respite. So, but keep your arms lengthened, legs lengthened. Closing in for 8 counts. Count you in 5, 6, 7, 8, and closing. So close, just close your arms and legs one time. Take the 8 counts, please. Really close in. Try to drop down. So if you don't have space, just overlap. Yeah? And open 8 counts. 6, 7. Just wait for the count in. Open 8. We're starting again from row 1 first with the right leg. So, right. Try to take the 4 counts for the lengthening and extend through the straight arm. That's good. And keep your legs wide though. Don't let your legs flap about. Closing. Extend. Priya, give her support, support, support. My middle toe is a bit messy, my front row. Okay. Okay, so I would like somebody, maybe the center line, to just say what you're doing every time so that your row goes, does the same thing at the same time. Their row is sort of doing that. The middle row starts to separate out a little bit and the front row. So would you like to devise a system that would help you? Do you want to say right leg or what would help?
Five,
one set. Everyone does one right, one extend, one left, one extend. Don't move after that, because I want you to go till the finish and close it one time and then restart. If we try to do too many in a row, everybody gets lost. Yeah? So know where to stop with them.
And it's a minimum of 4, 4, 4, 4, 4.
Yeah. So, you know, when we say the four counts, I would really like the movement to go till the end. 1, 2, 3, 4, and till the next one starts. Don't give me a full stop at the end, but just continue into the next movement. We'll talk about how to connect that. I count you in 5, 6, 7, 8, and four counts we are. Don't look up, that's not going to help. The last row is difficult, I know. Keep the legs wide, even when you fold them in, keep them wide. Your front row, you've lost one of your people. Front row, left leg, extending out. 5, keep one arm extended, nice. Closing in 8 counts. What did I say about stopping? Okay, the arms need to be extended. So that's why it's important everybody sort of tries to cover similar space, otherwise the line closes in. Okay, we're going to try it one more time. 6, no, no, stay 7, the row on the left, you're having a space problem, so just ask your partner to go a little bit further. So you're losing the front row, the two girls, you need to take him along. He's being left out and he's doing something completely different. So just maybe if you can keep looking this way and you please connect to your partner. So I think it's important to stay somehow connected across, not just lengthwise, that's the obvious physical connection, but so that you don't lose a sense of what people are doing. We are going to help you with the lengthening out. Are you using the hold of that foot to hold you in? Try to maybe use your center more. And less just glute strength. So really visualize from your center the line, the lengthened line. Don't focus on the crouching in. Five. I think it's easier with your head to a side because you have more flatness. 5, 6, 7, 8. Take the four counts, don't lose your flow after a point. We are head to the side. Front row, stay together. There is no position in which I ask you to fold back your arms. We are all out. 8 counts, closing. 8 counts. Shoulder blades try to drop and open. Okay. I'm just going to give you a couple of minutes to just try to sort out or make a system for yourselves to stay together with your horizontal roll. And also if there's anything you're not getting from your partners, you can address that at this point. Is anyone having a difficulty with the movement? Other than that it's difficult. So maybe talk about this, the idea of how to get a flow in the action. So does that make, have meaning for you when I use that term?
Because the energy is like constantly moving from back and forth, so the flow is definitely there of the energy.
So no, I don't want to talk about flow of energy either. Right now, let's just talk about movement. So, for me, the idea of when one moves with the idea of sustained movement and at this speed, you have two possibilities. Well, you have various possibilities, but if one doesn't understand how to find the flow in the movement, you end up having a very staccato, jerky sort of, you know, it starts and then it stops with a bang, and in between you have this, right? Which is also the nature of the problem of this movement working on the flow. But I think it's good to be able to understand, to use the time completely. Yeah? Otherwise, by having moments in the middle of the piece where everything is just stopping and moving. So for me to be able to see the whole larger animal that looks like it's moving as one beast and not as nine individuals, everybody has to maintain the usage of time the same way. Which means you don't stop at three. The front row especially, you know, you have to keep going on that with the lengthened arm, that it has to keep moving out 1, 2, 3, 4 till you get there. When you fold in the opposite leg, like say you're in this position, when you fold in the opposite leg, that's when you extend the bend and you never pull it back. Okay? Because you have to try to visualize what we're actually seeing and what we want to see. This animal is moving very slowly. But it has to move. So for us to understand this notion of the movement, you have to now start to bring further imagination, but right now at least the notion of keeping the movement going till the end of your time, right? So the front row, be very particular about the arms. Yeah, you never draw them back, and you have to keep the extension. So the pushing out is very important. The back row, I want to ask you a little bit more attention to the leg. Yeah? Because the movement away from the back space is what you're giving us through your leg. So never, I feel like after you do the movement the first time, you're a little bit tired, and then you stop paying attention to the quality of the second leg, for instance. So then the other thing to know is, we're working in the diagonals. If you fold your leg in like this, we lose the line. So try to visualize that you actually, when you fold your leg, that you maintain a sense of the diagonal and the knee is out a little bit, especially for the back row. So in the extension, it is difficult for you, yeah, the back row. Try to sustain as much as you can, and then see, the middle row shouldn't have a problem because you have support on both sides, the foot and the leg. So let's try to see if we can get it a little bit more together. I advise you to stay really flat with the head, it's easier. So the minute you start to pull back and lift the shoulder blades up, you're just losing the length. So then you're just losing length. So just really think of that, those few technical things. So just pull back into the space. So the closing and opening is 8 counts. It doesn't mean 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It means closing for 8 counts, opening. back into the space. You have to go forward. The middle row has lost. Can we start again? Middle row, who's in charge? Make now what happened. I'm counting. Just quietly, at least look at each other and see what's going on there. Right? I'm not going to be there when you talk. Lengthen arms, center. You just push, ask your partner to go a bit forward. Everyone's touching. Okay, this row, only fold your leg as much as you can, extend forward out of it. There's no use folding your leg up to here and then pushing back out, because then the animal is doing this. Right? So really understand, once you folded your leg in, you cannot go back from that. 5, 6, 7, 8, and finish early. Middle row, lengthen up. Take your time, make now. Girl in the center, you're holding well. Fold your left leg now. Middle row. Front row is hardly moving. Why is that? Okay. I see you're still not using the push back. Yeah, you're not, no? Is it because your partner is not giving you the support? That's really the thing to be careful of. Because remember, you're pulling yourself up at the same time that she's folding her leg. So, do you know which leg she needs to fold at what time? Do you know? So it's very, because I know that feeling, somebody's tugging at your leg and you're trying to pull it. So that you need to tell your partner what the problem is. Are you okay with your partner? Is it okay? He doesn't care. Okay, the other thing, back row, since you're more or less, just look at this, what happens when I do this. Okay?
That's the problem. One, two, three, four.
It's all happening all the time. You have to understand, you know, in a still moment like this, if you suddenly turn your head at the wrong point, if you need to turn, do it subtly. I don't know why you need to keep turning your head. Perhaps you're more comfortable on one side. But just realize that we see everything. And that's what makes the difference between seeing something without clutter and fidget. And so it's in the details eventually. That's the difficult thing. So just be a little bit conscious of that. Resolved?
I have a question. So while I'm pushing my partner on the other road, is it a match or do I give a
okay. Depends which arm you're talking about. So but just tell me which moment you're in.
So my right leg is being pushed and...
No, being pushed, I don't understand what you mean. When you fold in your right leg, after that,
right.
When you extend out, you can, this extended arm, it depends, you know, everybody has a different approach. Some people really push hard and that helps them. Some people don't push at all. They sort of just get pulled up by your partner. You can try both options. There's no one way for this. It just depends on your equation.
So my question is, whether I push her or do I give her a match that I'm overlapping?
You have to ask her that question, is what I'm saying.
Whether
I'm here
or not push, but you don't pull us.
Yeah.
It's a little bit of a push.
Just let it go. Just have the understanding that she's folding the leg, so don't hold her back. You also having some problem with folding in. Is your partner not moving enough?
She's so shame. So I put in, I think it's going to be for her about me.
Next question is yes.
Because you want to think so you're not moving the problem, so I was like, maybe it's changing.
Meghna, try to extend a little bit more the room time. Because you have, the middle row has it actually quite.
Can we try?
It's really important to start with everything lengthened, because otherwise as you go it's going to get, you're going to get more compression. So either that or you move back, maybe you could move back. So it makes a big difference to us, the viewer, when you really start connecting between you, both horizontally and vertically. So just try to keep that, so that even if you do something that doesn't finish in time or finishes late, that it's somehow still together with your group. That's going to make the difference. 5, 6, 7, 8. Head we talked about. What happened? Don't push back through the leg. Okay, maybe you're not doing a good job. Your partner in the center doesn't know what's going on. Okay. I mean, of course I could say row two, row two, row two. But it's just four simple actions. You should be able to do it. Partner in the middle, why are you falling out from the team? Yeah. Not aware. So why are you not aware? I just said before we started, stay connected to your horizontal line. What does that mean when I say that? This is the problem of dancers. I've seen it everywhere. We're so able to exist in a tiny little space and world. All you have to do is open your eyes. Yeah? You have to open your eyes and open your physical senses to the people. And you're really in the middle. You have the biggest advantage of being in the middle to connect. You have 8 people around you, but yet you're just being isolated. And this is not about doing the movement perfectly on your own, because actually that means nothing at all. So if you don't even know that you're falling out of the line, that's a real problem. Please do it wrong and know about it. Otherwise, we have no way of progressing with this idea of being in the group. You know what I'm saying? So, but you know, we all have different amount of experience. Some of us only work solo our whole life. Some of us haven't. And I think also in a situation like this, those of us who are used to working in group situations have to somehow give the momentum to the others to be able to come. You have to really pull them out of the situation. So Meghna, since I've given you the responsibility for your role, now you have to be responsible. Let's try again. Do you want water break? I thought I heard a good size there. Because none of you, some of you may know each other, but never really worked together. It's a special challenge. So already in this moment, try to extend the imagination to the larger group. 5, 6, 7. We can do the legs. Really hold the back space. Go on. Very nice. Give her, yes, a good. Extend the arms as well.
Okay, let's just go again.
this head movement right in the beginning is very problematic. I can give you four counts to turn your head only if you want. Very important. But maybe not. So just decide which side you want your head to be on before we start. Extend or extend a bit. Little girl, I'm always having a problem with these lines.
Now starting with the right leg, right at the base. It's a different awareness.
Yeah, it's a different awareness, but it's also, they have to know certain really just tangible technical things about how much weight to throw into the things, how much to push, how much to pull. Then you start to slowly discuss. You have to also understand, I think, the people who are in front of you, behind you. So it's like you're all the time grappling with having to do the movement yourself, but also provide the support. So it's, yeah, it's sort of a complex situation, but it's a situation which I think forces you, whether you like it or not, because it absolutely won't work if you just close into the space, right? Or if you start only just focusing on how am I moving my leg, the whole thing will collapse. So yeah, the notion of being together is, of course, can be understood in various situations. This is just one of them. And I just sort of, I chose this idea because it's, when you start off working this idea with the group, everyone thinks it's simple, and the more, it's a situation where you, the more you work and the more you look for the details and the quality, it's really opens up the complexity of the situation. And it would take days and days to really bring it into its own.
So it's interesting that when your horizontal on the floor on your belly, you're experiencing the full force of gravity.
Yes.
You're really getting pulled down.
Yes.
But the movement demands that it becomes light. So that's a little counter you need to find.
Yes, yes. Yeah. I think to find that kind of really the ability to allow the body to exist on this horizontal plane and to really understand what that is. You know, and then to visualize the movement is actually taking you in the horizontal plane. The minute you start fighting that and pulling up, like with the shoulder blades, like, you know, some people try to lift up the pelvis, you lose the connection to your center at once, you know, and then the flow gets completely ruined. So I think this, the work on horizontal plane, I like it because it sort of forces you to understand the alignment of the body.
So I have a question, like, what is the idea behind it? Because, for example, like, I was reading about this choreographer in the US, and he started doing crawl walk, and which still happens.
Yeah.
And he did it because, the reason was this, because out of racism he did it, and I was reading about, I don't remember the name, but, so he did the crawl walk, and which still happens in all of the world now.
Yeah.
Like, but there is an essence behind it, that the crawling means that they are trying to tell that whatever you have built it up with all these buildings and everything, but we have to be grounded. So that's why they are doing crawling. Army is doing because of their training, because of their awareness. So what is, definitely awareness is one of the things. So what instigates you, what is the initial point where you think about it? Definitely teamwork. It's a, and then when you mentioned that I'm interested in making rather than individual, a group. So what other things are there?
These are sort of, there are some things which I like to say about what I do, and there are some things I don't really want to say. Having said this, it's, for me, this belongs to a series of large animalistic forms. So it's not that I only did crawling ones, I have also standing up ones, where people have only the contact with the tops of their heads. I have ones on all fours, and I want to work on others. And it's also, it's for me, it's really about creating, I feel like the human body is structured in a way that it's almost like building, the body can become a building block or something. And I love to then see, find the logic of certain articulations in very particular ways. So that would be my sort of the mechanics of why I'm, for instance, exploring this. It's not my lifetime of work to crawl. No, I'm not joking. In a sense that it hasn't preoccupied me for a long time. It's just that, and I'll show you a small photo. footage of when I made this. It was in a room where people could watch from very high. And I just thought at that time, it's almost like, for me, at a certain moment, the whole image transforms, you know, even beyond the animal. So one can see many different things, but at the end of the day, it's for me somewhere about creating these dependencies and to somewhere to understand that the thing is much bigger than we are. That's been a perpetual work for me since I began to choreograph, to get the dancer to lose ego. And this is part of that particular kind of research. But that research manifests in different forms. So I don't do this all the time. In fact, in the piece I present, the after, there's nothing really on the floor.
Excuse me, I have
a
question.
Yes.
Tomorrow.
Does this work with the runway and for the dancing?
Tomorrow. Oh yeah, today is the open.
Does this work with a random group of dancers, or must the dancers be trained in a particular technique? Because in South Asia, we spend years training dancers.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I don't think of a situation like this to end up with sort of the perfectly executed structure. Right now, I'm not so interested in that. I think it's nice, in fact, with the group that I worked with in Madras, I even had one musician who wanted to try, who struggled and struggled and struggled. And everyone asked me, why have you got that boy? Because he's struggling and struggling. But at this point, to do this kind of work, I don't actually care. It's not about that it becomes perfect. It's about that everybody understands it, you know, in some way. You know, and you know, there are always weaker and stronger bodies, and there are always bodies whose training is better suited or less better suited. But it doesn't bother me.
So for you, it's not about dancers. It's more about...
Well, it's about them. It's about people, I think. It's about people at some level. And because I'm not sort of making it as a performance to go into Kamani or anything. It's sort of more the idea of me getting away in moments from the idea of the end result, which is the performance, but to still be in a creative space. So therefore, these are just sort of things I like to do. It doesn't take that much time, you know, and then sometimes I could work for 10 days with whoever's there and just do a very simple showing. So it's not something that that needs to finish somehow or be the best. But, shall we try it just once more? You can watch it because there was also, I don't have a complete film of it yet, it's in editing. But just for you to see, sometimes when we're lying on the floor suffering, it's very difficult to visualize. And it was the same in Madras with the dancers. It's only later, after everything was finished, when they saw themselves in film, that they had a sense of why I did this in the first place. Because it's really about this visual. So we can watch that, and then we can maybe have more questions. Sometimes you can really give it to a very strong person and they actually struggle the most. So it's not at all about muscular strength. You know, it's somewhere really about understanding the inner line of the body. That's been my experience. Because I've seen like these tiny, petite little dancers glide across, you know, and these big people who can do 100 push-ups just can't move. So it's really the understanding of technique is very important to make it work somehow. Should we flatten a bit more? So I'll count you and we'll start closing from the top. Five, six, seven, eight. Really better not to close your eyes. Okay, sorry, I need to start again. I just saw this very interesting crawling action. Can we just, why are you finding this difficult?
I don't know,
shoulder width, movement, so I just... Yeah, maybe start slightly narrower for you as well, not so wide. Try to just really sink down here. Yeah, okay. Use your center a little bit. Try to now start closing, yeah. Relax the arms and start moving from your spine. Yeah. Think of the length. You have two straight lines. All you want to do is this. Yeah? Even if they don't close completely, just come to this. Yeah, relax. The more you can let go of the tension which you don't want. Use your center prepared. Visualize the diagonal and then just find the extension away from your spine. Yeah, relax. Don't pick up. So it's really this windscreen wipe where you have to go through the surface. You have to engage the friction of the surface. And you have to allow the arm to push open the space and close, yeah? So, don't think, the movement doesn't start in the fingertips. That's exactly the wrong place to start thinking about the movement. Feel the two vertical lines before you open. Connect now across the horizontal. Open up the diamond spaces. Don't be in a hurry, you'll get stuck at the end. Be prepared, don't start groping around right at the last minute. Meghna. Okay, thank you. I won't make you suffer anymore. There's only unfortunately 1 minute of something, someone filming on their phone. But you can watch it just for you mostly, not the audience has been watching you. And then if there are any questions, I don't think you should really continue. Yeah. Middle of the so sorry. When I have the film edited, I will give you all a link.
So you go inward, and it's also years of a particular narcissistic
you know, staring in the mirrors, how do I look, you know, like what is my, you know, body, all of these things that involve the individual, the self-image of the dancer. And the minute I started to initially I was working with smaller groups, so 4 or 5 dancers, and it really started to bother me that I was seeing so much of this sort of focus on the self, and in a sense that, you know, somebody could be falling on their face at the other end of the stage and the dancer would just still be, you know, not even aware. So this ability that we have to not be fully aware of everything that's happening around us started to make me realize that there has to be a way for the dancer to get out of this notion of what do I look like, or, you know, which is a very big baggage that a lot of dancers do with. So over the years, you know, we have different ways that I would articulate that, and different dancers come with it different in different forms. Also, this you know, notion of how do I look. And I think that the ability to then disengage that and to actually send energy out into the collective spaces, to visualize those in between spaces. I mean, it's also part of, in a way, ongoing or sort of the work we started to do also with Chandra, you know, who was also very much asking us to really engage the other and the in between space and to not put all our energy into this form. So I think that, and sometimes it's like the transformation of something simple is astounding. You know, the minute you get dancers, it's just a simple shift sometimes. You know, it's as simple as me saying, I'm not going to be in my body, I'm going for this time, Rhea needs help from me because she's finding that difficult. I'm going to take Rhea with that. You know, and I'm going to be in Rhea for this moment. And it's a very nice way, I think, of sharing strength and energy without physically doing it. But it's just all, it's a very imagined sort of technique.
Yeah. I have a question related to this, which is the idea of the imagining the collective, so that you take yourself out of yourself and expand your view. Whether there's a way of articulating that, whether you've developed a way of actually sharing this.
Yeah, I mean, articulating can only go so far. But what I do in situations with my group is, I set up very precise exercises for them to work the material they eventually have to perform, but to insist and insist and to keep talking through the exercise, so that the minute I see the energy is gone, you know, somewhere, to talk about that, you know, this is the dead space, you know, somebody's dropped out, can you please bring them back in? So it's a question of just initially giving a lot of information and reminding, you know, because otherwise, just, oh, how long is my arm, you know, we just fall back into this. I'm not really interested beyond the point of how long is your arm. Your arm can be as long as you want, but it's in the imagination somewhere. So it's really to keep reminding, I think, you know, until it becomes a part of the dancer's practice. And I, for myself, found it also a very useful thing to do when I'm a soloist. You know, it's not just, once you've performed the action with 9 dancers, imagine taking away the 9. The solitary body in the space has as much potential to invoke the 9 dancers. You know, but it takes that understanding of, you know, the larger situation. And to be able to actually, yeah, to invoke that.
So the formations are like yours. For example, this one where you open up your out and watch. But I'm shastriti moment is that what are your other inspirations in the formations and the kind of movement that comes through? Because just to add one more, it's like because a lot of these things are very easily when you need to do it with someone to feel or to develop. But as an outsider, how can you still be constantly inspired just by watching what are your other inspirations?
What are my other inspirations? Well, with most of my work, it's really grown in the studio. And it's really grown out of just dealing with this physical object. And it's, for me, I think over the years, I've been so involved in a certain relationship to teaching, to pedagogy, because I'm all the time training dancers. And so over the years, I've been looking for, I think, ways to actually teach something. So if you ask me at the end of this session, but Padmini, what did you really want to teach? What I really actually want to teach is for somebody in the group to understand the connection between this fingertip and this toe. You know, having said that, it's not a very easy relationship, but I would use a process like this for the dancers, and I hope they think about a few of these things later, to really understand why is the simple action of just closing the arms difficult for someone. So, you know, where are the blocks of a particular body? How do we open those? It's only sometimes when you throw dancers into very difficult situations that the realization of how little they know hits them. And I'm not somebody when I'm working with dancers, I don't say, oh, it's wrong, it's bad, go home and do it again. But I like them to really know there's so much work to keep doing with the body. And I feel more and more when I work with young dancers that they're so caught up with this whole thing of the gymnastic and the acrobatic and the flashiness of dance. But you ask them to close their arms in four counts, they actually can't do it. And I don't want to say anything about that, but I do hope that they'll actually go away and think about what was that, you know? Where was that coming from and what was that technique? So, so as I said, a lot of my ideas grow really from within, and years of working with these situations. And I like it. I mean, I think the, I like the idea of, the way the body is so logical, in the movement. It sort of begs for it to be used in the structural way. And so I'm starting to look for these sorts of possibilities.
I have one question. You started Bharatanatyam at a very early age, and is there any, there must be many contributions to the training, but has it really inspired you to do the work that you're doing right now, or how much has it inspired you? The training for so long?
No, I did for 10 years. No, I'm so far away. I mean, I have to honestly say it doesn't inspire me at all. I mean, sometimes if I see a really nice dancer, of course I can appreciate it. But for what I'm interested, or for how I'm interested in working with the body, I don't anymore feel myself going into that.
I have one question, which is somewhat related to the demonstration here. When in such a situation where the dancers are supposed to work in a team and have this sort of connection, how is it that they're supposed to interpret this energy? Because, I mean, energy is something very personal also, like dancers tend to go inside and you know, feel like, okay, if my toe is connected to my arm, this is how I interpret it. So everyone might have different ways of interpreting it as well, but in a theme, it has to be in sync.
It has to be in sync, it doesn't have to be the same, and that's different.
Okay, so how is it that...
So what brings it together in time is that they can interpret the time, and I think time is fairly a non-personal for me. I mean, of course, the way we use time in each other's in different choreographic practices is very different. But in a situation like this, there's an absolutely solid compositional grid to which the dancers are pinning onto, which brings, has the potential to bring the collective together. Now, of course, if we're talking about the quality of movement, it can be very different, you know, and that doesn't bother me at all. As long as there is a quality, you know, that's telling me something about how that body is negotiating, you know, the movement in space. So I'm not looking for that I want everything to be exactly the same. No, in fact, I like to see the way different dancers approach it differently, you know. But I personally feel, you know, there's, the body is the body. Some of us have longer arms, some of us have wider shoulder blades, and some of us have problems that are born out of years of wrong training, social problems, you know, all sorts of things that freeze certain parts of the bodies. But I honestly think, you know, somebody who wants to be a dancer and is working with the body, that's really the work, you know, to free the body from those kinds of problems which get you stuck. Technically, you know, so that's all part of a longer process. I mean, yeah, you can't do much. This was just one day. But,
can I just going back to what maybe I missed a little bit in the beginning? Just without the movement, just then land on the feet. Even before movement begins. Where are they, what part of the body are they energizing? That might be the core to his problem of not being able to move his arms and neck, creating a lot of tension in the shoulders. For me, if he had, just an observation, if he had tightened the abdomen and realized that the movement was, the control
but
was coming
Neela, the tightening, I think this is what you call tightening. Thinking about the center, if he had been doing that for a year before today, then you can understand how to move without, but the habit of tightening wrong muscles is unfortunately a long habit.
Absolutely.
To lose those habits.
Suggesting
that
if he or any of them worked the movement, the legs or the hands, from the abdomen.
Yeah, absolutely.
Of course.
It's also that, it's also the ability to drop down the pelvis and the rib cage. It's also the ability to visualize, you know, the lines of the arm. Right? So there are many sort of things to address.
Just the lying down itself is such a potent position.
It's much easier on your back.
No,
on your stomach, it's definitely a challenge.
Last question.
Is there an anything saying technique constantly? And I'm just wondering, and you also said that the body's logic is to do things a certain way. So is your technique and the body is. Is your coming to technique also just coming to using the body or delving into the body's logic itself and working with that?
The thing is, I think it's more complex. Somewhere, it's, yeah, I understand why you're connecting the two.
Okay.
But actually, you know, very young children have perfect body logic. It's untainted. But it's very different, but they don't have technique. So therefore I use this example. So I mean, in a lot of dance training today, we're relearning the movement of babies and children. Why is that? Because you never find a baby crawling wrongly. You know, but you ask a human being to crawl, it will be absolutely terrible. You know, it's not connected to the center, it's not coordinated. The spine is either arching or rounding. The tension is, you never saw a baby like this.
Yeah.
But you see many grown-ups. So I think, for me, the way I approach the arriving at what I call techniques today is, yeah, so on the one level you're trying to decode or to trace that into a certain ability till you reach the moment where you feel the body is really moving in an anatomically sound manner. Right? Because it's very difficult to say, okay, I'm going to be the baby, you know, because that's so difficult. I have like decades of layers of doing absurd things with my body layered over this baby. Okay? But to understand that, yeah, and to really get into the anatomic structure of my body has helped a lot. Because now it's not, you know, a lot of the time, as Leela was saying, we can keep saying center, center, center. But that's a very complex thing, you know. But for me, when I work technique with my dancers, I really try to get them to really understand the structural eye movement. So, not just muscle, but really to get into the bones, you know, and to think skeletal. Sometimes that really helps, you know, to really understand how to move without adding the wrong sort of tensions, unless you want them. You see, those are for me aesthetic choices then, at the end of the day. So there's a technical starting point, but you can decide. I mean, I could have told them, okay, when you crawl, lift the shoulder blade up. That's then an aesthetic choice.
Yeah.
You know, then one has to address technique for that to suit that aesthetic choice.
But I mean, in terms of like, when you asked him to bring his shoulder down, because you didn't want the up to the side.
No, purely because it's getting him stuck.
Okay.
The reason here I chose to work with the flatness is because then I feel you actually get much more length in the arms and much better ability to flow. The minute you start squeezing into the shoulder blades, you know you're immediately, that's what I mean by, those are technical things. And that I know. I know for somebody to move their arms with the quality I want, for that the shoulder blade needs to be this way. So that's the way I arrive at my, at the technical corrections which I give to dancers. Thank you.